ഈ വർഷത്തെ നമ്മുടെ രണ്ടാമത്തെ മീറ്റിംഗ് ആണ് നമ്മൾ നടത്തുന്നത്. രണ്ടു മൂന്ന് കാരണങ്ങൾ കൊണ്ട് കുറച്ച് പേരൊക്കെ നാട്ടിൽ പോയിരിക്കുകയും ക്രൈസ്റ്റിൽ ധ്യാനം നടക്കുകയും പന്ത്രണ്ട് വാർഡുകളിൽ ഓണാഘോഷം നടക്കുകയും ചെയ്തുകൊണ്ട് കുറച്ച് പേരൊക്കെ കുറവാണ് എന്ന് നമുക്കറിയാം. അല്ലെങ്കിൽ നമ്മുടെ ഓഡിറ്റോറിയം നിറഞ്ഞു കവിയുന്നതായിരുന്നു സാധാരണ. ഇന്നത്തെ ദിവസം നമുക്ക് ക്ലാസ്സിനായി എത്തിയിരിക്കുന്നത് ടിപ്സ് ഫോർ ഹാപ്പിനെസ് എന്നുള്ള വിഷയത്തെ കുറിച്ച് നമുക്ക് സ്ട്രെസ് മാനേജ്മെന്റ് ബന്ധപ്പെട്ട് സന്തോഷകരമായ ജീവിതം ഈസി ലൈഫ് അതുമായി ബന്ധപ്പെട്ട് ക്ലാസ് എടുക്കാൻ എത്തിയിരിക്കുന്നത് കുര്യൻ കാച്ചപ്പള്ളി അച്ഛൻ. കുര്യൻ കാച്ചപ്പള്ളി അച്ഛനെ സെന്റ് തോമസ് യൂത്തിന്റെ സെന്റ് തോമസ് യൂത്തിന്റെയും പ്രൊഫഷണൽ ഫോറത്തിന്റെയും ഏറ്റവും സ്നേഹപൂർവ്വം സ്വാഗതം ചെയ്യുന്നു. കുര്യൻ കാച്ചപ്പള്ളി അച്ഛനെ ഒന്ന് പരിചയപ്പെടുത്തുകയാണ്. എൻ്റെ അധ്യാപകനാണ്, ഞങ്ങളുടെ എല്ലാം അധ്യാപകനാണ്. കുര്യൻ കാച്ചപ്പള്ളിയുടെ ഒരു വേദ പറയാം, ഹി ഈസ് ദ ഇന്റലക്ച്വൽ ഫേസ് ഓഫ് സി എം ഐ കോൺഗ്രിഗേഷൻ. സി എം ഐ കോൺഗ്രിഗേഷന്റെ ബൗദ്ധിക മുഖമാണ് കുര്യൻ കാച്ചപ്പള്ളി അച്ഛൻ. അച്ഛൻ ഇപ്പോൾ ധർമ്മാരാമിലും അതുപോലെ തന്നെ ക്രൈസ്റ്റ് യൂണിവേഴ്സിറ്റിയിലും അധ്യാപകനായിട്ട് ജോലി ചെയ്തു. ഇതിനു മുമ്പ് ഭോപ്പാൽ കോൺസിന്റെ പ്രൊവിൻഷ്യലായിരുന്നു. ഒത്തിരിയേറെ ഏഴോളം ഏഴെട്ട് വിദേശ രാജ്യങ്ങളിലെ പ്രശസ്തങ്ങളായ യൂണിവേഴ്സിറ്റികളിലെ വിസിറ്റിംഗ് പ്രൊഫസറാണ് ബഹുമാനപ്പെട്ട കുര്യൻ കാച്ചപ്പള്ളി അച്ഛൻ. അതിനകത്ത് ലുവൻ ബെൽജിയത്തിലെ ലുവൻ യൂണിവേഴ്സിറ്റി ഉൾപ്പെടെ അതിനകത്ത് വരുന്നു. ലോകത്തിന്റെ എല്ലാ കോണ്ടിനെന്റ്സിലും അച്ഛൻ യാത്ര ചെയ്തിട്ടുണ്ട്. 70-80 രാജ്യങ്ങൾ സന്ദർശിച്ചിട്ടുണ്ട്. ഒത്തിരിയേറെ സെമിനാറുകൾ ഓർഗനൈസ് ചെയ്തിട്ടുണ്ട്. ഇന്ത്യയിലെ തന്നെ അറിയപ്പെടുന്ന ഫിലോസഫേഴ്സ് തത്വചിന്തകരിൽ ഒരാളുണ്ട്, ജീവിച്ചിരിക്കുന്ന തത്വചിന്തകൾ ഒരാളുണ്ട്. ഒരു 10 ഇന്ത്യയിലെ ഏറ്റവും മികച്ച 10 ഫിലോസഫേഴ്സിനെ എടുത്തു കഴിഞ്ഞു. കുര്യൻ കാച്ചപ്പള്ളി അച്ഛൻ്റെ പേര് അതിനകത്തുണ്ട്. അച്ഛനെ കുറിച്ചുള്ള കൂടുതൽ പ്രൊഫൈൽ വാട്സപ്പ് വഴി നിങ്ങൾക്ക് അയച്ചു തന്നിരുന്നു ഓൾറെഡി. ഇതെല്ലാം ഉപരിയായിട്ട് ഒറ്റ വാക്ക് കുര്യൻ കാച്ചപ്പള്ളി അച്ഛനെ കുറിച്ച് പറയുകയാണ്. കുര്യൻ കാച്ചപ്പള്ളി അച്ഛൻ എന്ന് പറയുന്നത് വളരെ ജെന്റിൽമാൻ, ഒരു ജെന്റിൽമാനായ വ്യക്തിയാണ് അദ്ദേഹം. ധർമ്മാരാമിന്റെ വരാന്തകളിലൂടെ വളരെ നിഷ്കളങ്കനായി ഒരു പഴയ ശ്രദ്ധ കേട്ട് വളരെ കൂളായിട്ട് നടന്നു പോകുന്ന, പിന്നെ ഞങ്ങളെല്ലാം വർത്തമാനം പറഞ്ഞ് തമാശ വന്ന് ചിരിച്ച് കളിച്ചു പോകുന്ന ഒരു അച്ഛനാണ്. ഇതെല്ലാം പ്രിയപ്പെട്ട ഒരു അച്ഛനാണ്. ഇത് നമ്മൾ മനസ്സിലാക്കേണ്ട ഒരു കാര്യമാണ്, വലിയ മനുഷ്യര് ഒത്തിരിയേറെ വളർന്നു കഴിയുമ്പോൾ അവർ എത്രമാത്രം ചെറുതായി തീരുന്നു എന്നുള്ളത് ഈ ഒരു സൂചനയാണ്. മനുഷ്യർ വളരെ വലിയ ആൾക്കാർ വലുതായി പോകുന്നു, അവർ ചെറുതാകുന്നത് നമുക്കൊക്കെ വലിയൊരു മോഡലാണെന്ന് മാത്രമാണ്. നമുക്കും കുര്യൻ കാച്ചപ്പള്ളി വരുന്ന നല്ല ഇന്റലക്ച്വൽ ജായിച്ച എന്നതിലുപരിയായി നമുക്കെല്ലാം നല്ല ഞങ്ങളുടെ നല്ലൊരു മോഡലും നല്ലൊരു അധ്യാപകനും നല്ലൊരു കൂട്ടുകാരും നല്ലൊരു സെന്നാറിയും അച്ഛനെ ഇന്നത്തെ ക്ലാസ് നയിക്കുന്നതിനായി ഏറ്റവും സ്നേഹപൂർവ്വം സന്തോഷ ജീവിതത്തിനെയും പോഷണത്തിനെയും സ്വാഗതം ചെയ്യും.
Jayesu, Namaste, and good morning. So let's say good morning.
Good morning.
Come on guys, a bit louder. Good morning.
Good morning.
You said that's much better. I'm Kurian, feel free to call me Kurian. That's the way my students made in Christ or GBK address. First thing, relax. Because the topic is Hakuna Matata. I'd be happy if you can hear.
Hakuna Matata. What a wonderful phrase.
Hakuna Matata. Ain't no cares and worries. It means no worries for the rest of your days. It's all trouble free.
What is Hakuna Matata? I hope you have seen the film, The Lion King. Come on, yes? No?
Yes.
Yeah, yes, there are some who have seen. Now, Hakuna Matata, don't worry. This is Swahili, it's an African language spoken in Kenya, Tanzania, Uganda, in the East African countries. And simply means, don't worry. Today, as the poet Davis captures, what is his life full of care, no time to stand and stare. Are you following me? I wish to talk in Malayalam, but my Malayalam is not that very good. I left Kerala when I was a young boy. All my studies is either in North India or in Europe. Therefore, yes, I do understand Malayalam pretty well, but to talk to you young people, maybe that I'm not competent. But you can ask anything if you like in Malayalam, in Hindi, in German, in English, and Dutch. No problem. I can manage. Okay? So please, relax, don't worry. And that's the topic we are going to discuss. Don't worry, be happy. Hakuna Matata. I don't know, having introduced as a philosopher, perhaps some of you might have heard about some of the philosophers' name, like Socrates, Aristotle, Plato. These are the three giants from Greece. Now here, there is a text from Aristotle. Now don't be scandalized. All what we learn in our catechesis is from this man, but not directly from Aristotle, but through St. Thomas Aquinas, the giant, the doctor of the church. St. Thomas is called, not St. Thomas the Apostle, please. Are you following me? We have some faces. If you have difficulty, I will be very slow. And if you don't understand, just put up your hand. Because my intent is that everybody should follow. Because the topic is, don't worry. Okay? So Aristotle, in his famous book on ethics, the Nicomachean Ethics, he wrote this sentence. You can also read, happiness is the meaning of life. Happiness. He said, all what we do aims at just one and same thing. What is that? Happiness. He said, that's the end. If you are asked to live, if you are asked this question, why do you live? We ask you a question from the catechesis. Catechesis, prologue number one. Why did God create us? Now, who is best in catechesis? Anybody? Why did God create us? Oh, I'm sorry. No more questions. You see? Now, catechesis says to know Him, to love Him, and to serve Him. And then, thus enter in His bliss. What is bliss? You don't know bliss? Yeah, happiness. That's what catechesis is all about. Now, Aristotle said the same thing. Happiness is the end of our life. Now, surprisingly, how many of you have heard about the number one university of the world, Harvard? Put up your hands. Yeah, there are a quite number of people. Now, in Harvard University, there's a professor, a young man of 36, called Ben Shahar. He's offering a course every year, and every semester, 1,400 students attend this course. And what is the title of the course? How to be happier right now. Can you imagine about 20% of the Harvardians attend this course? And that's the most popular program offered at the Harvard University. I was there last November. Just imagine why people, especially the young people, throng to this program of Ben Shahar. Because the importance of being happy. That's why at the beginning I said, don't worry, be happy. Hakuna Matata. Hakuna Matata, don't worry, be happy. Therefore, let us talk. What we can do so that we will be happy. Now, this is our interaction. Now, come on, guys. Now, let me present Brian Dyson, the CEO of Coca-Cola America. This is a 30-minute lecture. He did 30 seconds lecture. Brian Dyson gave to his 6,000 employees. Look at here. Brian Dyson, the CEO of Coca-Cola USA. He said, we all are jugglers. Who is a juggler? Have seen circus? Jugglers trying to keep the ball in space. That's what called juggling. You can see here. That man is juggling with 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 balls. So he said, we all are, you and I, we all are jugglers. And what are we juggling with? 5 balls. Can we read? What are the 5 balls which are there? Yes, work. Those who are studying, they can write work, hyphen, or bar, then study. Second, we have family. You see, there are 5. Can you remember that? Work, family, health, friend, and spirit. Now, look at the explanation. Take the first one. The first ball, that is work or study, is made up of rubber. It's a rubber ball. Now, if you drop a rubber ball, what would happen? It will bounce back. Who is the physicist best here? What is the law in operation? Which law? Which law? Come on, physics. Oh, come on. Yes? Nobody said it? Which one? Yes, third law of Newton. The third law of motion. What is that? Yes, to every action, there is an equal and opposite reaction. That's why when we drop a rubber ball, it bounces back. Those who play basketball know quite well. You see, therefore, Brian Dyson said, even if you drop the ball, your work or your study, don't worry, it will not be damaged, it will not be broken, it will bounce back. If not today, tomorrow, another job, another study. But what about the other balls? Family, health, friends, and spirit? They are made up of glass. They are glass balls. Just imagine you drop a glass. What would be the result? Yes, it can be broken. It can be damaged completely or partially. You see, our family is such. If the family ties are broken, our health is such. If you don't care too much about our health, our friendship is such. Once broken, so too our relation with the Spirit of God. These are all made up of glass. Therefore, we have to handle with care. Have you seen 7 packets of them? Handle with care? Yes? What does it mean? What does it mean? Yes, it's fragile, it's weak, it's tender. Therefore, care more. That's exactly what we are talking about. Our family is very fragile, is very tender. If you don't care well, today one of the problems, especially in the city of Bangalore, is this broken families. You see, many sociological studies have brought up the statistics. They say at least 2 in 10 families, there are some problems. Either they are separated, or they are divorced, or they stay together in the same roof, but they don't see each other. They don't talk. I don't know what is your experience, your family. I just remember the love we received from our papa, mama, our brothers, our sisters, and that would make our family. But today, is family something alien? Do we feel at home You know the expression at home? In English, at home. What is at home? Are you following me? Because I have now more and more doubt. Because people are so silent. Is that way you are taught? In your, how many of you are now working? Please put your hand. Those who are working. Only a few students doing studies. Nobody. Very few. Then what are the others? No work, no study. Job hunters. I am also a job hunter. If you can tell me a good job, okay, I am there. Okay, now, so the first point we have to keep in mind is this. How do we relate to our family? What about our health? Is it important? Yes. How much money we spend to doctors in the hospitals? You see, hospitals are springing up like mushrooms everywhere. And you go to any hospital, it is crowded. Why so? Today, more and more people are sick. I don't know what are the reasons. Maybe junk food, maybe all kinds of drinks available in the market. You remember, I am an ardent fan of Coca-Cola. What kind of similarity they don't like? I don't know, because of my bringing up, my first option for drinking is Coca-Cola. What you say, they call it cola. See? But I don't know. They say that is 90% pesticides in cola. But I have proven one thing for sure. One day we are traveling with the five fathers from Thakmara, including rector. One of the fathers had the problem, stomach upset. I told the driver, stop the car near a shop. I bought a bottle of Coca-Cola. I asked him to drink two glasses. And he drank, he said, he was perfect. Why 90% pesticide killed all the birds? So that he was perfectly all right. Believe me, I am a testimony for that. Thereby, I don't advocate that you should drink Pepsi and Coca-Cola. The point of saying is that health is very important. Now, what about friendship? Because I can talk 3-4 hours on this topic alone, but that's not my purpose. Okay, my purpose is come to be happier. Now, friends, today in social media, you see, last year I gave a talk in Christchurch City for the media meeting. 800 plus students. Is media important? Yes? Communication media? The Twitter, the blog, the Facebook, the LinkedIn, academia, what else not? I have an entry in Facebook called Gurukulam. I have more than 5,000 plus my friends, my students. I am very active there. Also in Twitter, also in blog. But the question is, what about the media? Let's not forget, media can make a person a hardcore criminal and also a saint. It all depends how we maneuver and manipulate the social media. Then finally I would say, what about our relationship with God? Is it important? Or are we the followers of Nietzsche who said God is dead? Have you heard about that very famous story of Nietzsche? Nietzsche is a philosopher from Germany. One fine morning, an apparently mad man was running through the street, asking the question, where is God? At the beginning, nobody took seriously. Finally, this man arrived at a marketplace where hundreds of people gathered. He jumped into their midst and asked the same question, have you seen God? And one of them jokingly asked, like a baby, has he run away? Then the madman says, I will tell you. First his proclamation, God is dead. Then he corrected himself and said, no, we killed him. You and I are the murderers. That's Nietzsche. And he asked the question, why have you done that? why have we killed God? Any answer? Have we killed God? Have we? Maybe I should give another 2 hours lecture for that. Have we killed God? Nietzsche says, you and I are his murderers. You see, therefore, the four glass balls, family, health, friends, and spirit, they should be handled, my dear, carefully. Otherwise, we will weep, we will cry, we will regret. So, not to be happy, the first tip is care for family, care for health, care for friendship, and care for our dear God. Number one. Now, based on that, what are to be followed? Now, our practical tips. First thing, don't compare among yourselves. Keep this so close to your heart, my dear friends. Forget about comparison. What's the meaning of compare? Anybody? What is the idea of comparison? Come on. Oh, my classes are much better. There is one question, 100 answers. Here, one question, no answers. What's the meaning of to compare? Compare, pair with. So comparison means a pair. Yeah. Now among you, where is a pair? Can we say pair of people? Are you following pair? You see, we can say pair of shoes. We don't say shoe. We always say plural. Why? You need two. You can have just one leg, one shoe. No, that's not possible. You see, therefore we say shoes. So pair of shoes. A pair of gloves. You can't talk about, okay, I will be only half. No, it's a pair of glass. Now, similarly, can we say a pair of girls, a pair of boys, a pair of students? No, there is no comparison. Each and every person is unique. You understand the word unique? What's the meaning of unique? What's the meaning of unique? Yes, unique means one without a second. There is no copy, there is no duplicate, there is no replication. You are not convinced. You are not convinced? Look at each other. Now, three important aspects of a person. That's what I am going to present next. Then you can check. You see, when I say person, three important words should come to your mind. What are they? Name, face, and voice. Do you have a name? Yes, why so? Shakespeare in Midsummer Night wrote, after all, what is there in a name? Does name mean something? Yes? Yes or no? Yes. But how often do we use the name? We the Mandus, see the expression Mandus? Because in the college campus, always people are using short forms, the abbreviation, the Mandus and the Chandus and the Chulus and the Kandus and the Mandus. Who are the Mandus? Chandus, Chablians, Chulus, Telugus, Kandus, Kannadigas, and Mandus, Malayalis. You know Mohanlal's address, Malayali, as a child. We Malayalis have a good habit. What is that? We never take the name. We have a typical culture. What is that? Eda Boda Gada Gada culture. Am I right? How often we call? We are not calling proper nouns, we are calling pronouns. He, she, they, it. That's in Malayalam, Eda, Boda, Edi, Bodi. Unfortunately, I made a mistake. When I became provincial, I made a declaration in my province, no priest should call anybody Eda, Bodi. Then I was the only person who did not call. Similarly, I called the sisters and the ladies, never ever call my priest Eda, but no one about it. Because we are notorious for that Kerala Mandu culture, Eda Boda. But my dear, that's not a good thing. I was there for a meeting YCS Vaisa. I don't know, I heard about YCS Vaisa. All angels. There was a point of discussion. One senior sister from AC Convent, she's almost 70. She called one of the young boys, Moni. You understand Moni? And the boy was so angry. And the boy asked that 70-year-old sister, did you mother me? Did you mother me? And then added, mind your language, I have a name. This is today's gen. The new gen means respect. And the first sign of respect is call by name. And that makes you happy. I know. I told in the class, don't call me father, father, father. Teacher, teacher, teacher. Anybody is a teacher, anybody is a father. But Korean? Korean is Korean. And I am happy when that is called. I'm sure when your name is called out, you will be happy. Now, unfortunately, this is first time I'm meeting. In my class, I know everybody's name. The first 2 days, I learned all the names. That's my policy. Let me Christ University, let me giving it, let me anywhere in the world. See? So the first thing about a person who is without any comparison is name. Now, second, face. You see how many faces? Show me two faces, they are the same. You think there are two same faces? You can look at each other. Look at your left and right and see. Is there any copy? Let me ask you a very general question. Have you seen what we call identity parade in film at least? What is an identity parade? A crime is committed. There are no real criminals caught, but there are suspects. Then there will be a parading of the possible criminals. That's what we call identity parade. Now, which part of the person is shown for identity parade? Yes? Which? Why face? Why not legs? Why not any other part of the body? Why face is shown for identity parade? Because face is something unique. Especially your eyes, your nose, your lips, and especially also jaw. These are typically yours. There is no copy for that. You see, there is something called missiograph. You can read the face. How? Looking at your eyes. Now, let me give one experience. After studying in Louvain, Belgium, I came back to teach in Thermaram. So I thought maybe some demonstration in the class will not be bad. So for the first time, I introduced, now don't feel bad about that demonstration. I asked 10 brothers to line up. And I called 10 ladies to line up, including some sisters happened to be there. And I told them, stand face to face. So just imagine, are you hearing me? 10 brothers on one side, 10 ladies including 2 sisters on the other side. Now I told them, look into the face, look into the eyes, and stay there 1 minute looking to the eyes alone. You think they managed? What do you think? Could the brothers, could the ladies do that? Nobody. All the 20 failed looking to the eyes. They look everywhere, not to the eyes. How come? How come? What kind of training we have? I taught them very clearly, focus into the eye, try to see the eyeball, nothing else. And in 5 seconds, winking, winking. I asked them 1 minute. I didn't ask them 3 hours. You see, that's what we are. Maybe we don't want to see our face. So therefore, face is something typically yours. There is no second face equal to you. Now, third one, as a person, is your voice. Now the question is, do you have a say? Do you have a say in life? Yes? Do you have a say in life? Yes or no?
No.
Yes. Oh, come on. Do you have a sane life? What about here, so many young men? Do you have a sane in your life? Nobody sane. The point of saying, yes, I have my own sane. And others should respect that. Now, when I say I have my say, don't mean I am always right and others are always wrong. See, that is not the point. The point is, I have also my own perspective. You see, for example, take an example. Now, look at this table. Perhaps you see this side better than I can. Am I right? Whereas I can see what is happening here. Therefore, my saying will be much better about this side, the back side, than the front side. Front side, you people will be better judges. Everything has different perspectives. Similarly, if there are 10 people, there are 10 or more opinions. Therefore, what is being said? That we have our own voice and that should be respected. Now, three things: name, face, and words. Everything is different. Now I am going to conclude about that. No equality can be expected. Nobody is equal. Because especially among the youth, one big issue, where is equality and justice? My conclusion is, equality is only a myth. Do you think there is equality? Yes or no? Where do you find equality? Give me an instance. Give an example where there is a question of equality. Are you all equal? Take physically. Take intellectually. Take spiritually. Take your emotional aptitude. Are you all same? Then why do you talk about equality? Now, very simple example. Look at your fingers, please. How many fingers? Sure. Now, are they all same? Why not? You see, all the fingers are quite different. Why God did not make all the fingers the same? I made a demonstration in the class, an experiment. I asked the brothers to bring stick and thread and twines. And in 2 hours' time, I asked them to make all the 5 fingers same width, length, and thickness. They tried and tried and tried. Finally, they came up with the 5 fingers which are same. Now I asked them to take a piece of chalk. You think they managed? No. They couldn't take a chalk piece when all the fingers were same length and width and thick, because it didn't come together. You see, this is reality with our own hand. Therefore, the question equality, although in our Indian constitution, one of the key words is equality. Equality, freedom, and fraternity. That is the 3 catchwords in our Indian constitution preamble. But my contention is equality is just a myth. Look at the nature. Look at our family. Are all our siblings the same? I have a brother, 4 sisters. Nobody is like me. I am the shortest. My younger brother, I have to look this way, a tall guy. When I left for the congregation, we were the same height. I am senior to him, but he is a younger guy and now he is taller. Why so? I would have asked God, why you make me so short? Even my sisters are taller than me. Now the question is, where do equality come in? Anybody? One point that we discern from the Bible. Bible also speaks about inequality, but equality as well. You remember the parable of the talents? A man went for a journey, he called his servants. One he gave 5, another he gave 2, a third one, 1. Now when he came back, he asked for accounts. Now the first one came and said, you gave me, sir, 5, I have produced another 5. What is the percentage of production? 5, another 5. Percentage. Mathematician. Yes?
Another
Yeah, 100% change. 100% change. Become 505, 100% change. Now the second guy came, Master, you gave me two, I produced another two. What is the percentage? Yes? Again, 100%, same reward. Five, another 500%, two, another 200%. Now what happened to the third guy who received one? He forgot about his talent. He compared, oh, God gave him five, God gave him two. So much so he was worried, anxious, suspicious about the loyalty of God, and then he did nothing. He believed his talent, and Jesus says, the master was so angry. You see, I said, you faithless servant, you see, punishment, why? What is supposed of him? If you would have made another one, that would have made 100%. You see, five, another five, two, another two, then one, another one would have made 100% difficult. Therefore, what happened? He was so unhappy in life. Whereas others were awarded, he was punished. Equality in performance. The question is, are we giving our 100%? Pope Francis wrote his famous letter, Witnesses of John. In that he asked this question, are you giving 100%? Especially when you are working, when you are studying, when you are playing, when you are enjoying with your friends. Are you giving 100%? And when you are in the chapel or in the church, are you giving 100%? I dare not to ask the question what Pope Francis asked. Pope Francis asked this question, especially in the context of the religious. Is Jesus your first and only love? Suppose I ask this question to you. Is Jesus the only love? I'm not sure. Is it the first love? I know we love 101 loves. That's the advantage of social media now. See, now, so this is the first point I want to talk about. Don't compare. God has endowed us with the unique gifts, which has no comparison, no matching whatsoever. That's the first point. Now the second which follows from that, especially for those who are working. You see, it's a dream of every person to do what you love. You see, before becoming a priest, I was teaching at a government university. I was teaching Shakespeare in a British university. At that time, I never thought I would be a sermon. See, now, I enjoyed my teaching Shakespeare, therefore I could quote Shakespeare very fluently, text from any English. But now, so we ask the question, do you do what you love? That's a dream, but how many will get that option? Especially those who are working. Do you have 100% satisfaction? And those who are studying, do you get the choice of your, the place of your choice? You see, this year in Christ University, for your just information, we had 54,000 applications. 54,000 plus applications we received. Many more issued, but we received. Out of which, how many admissions we could take? 6,730. Just imagine the number of applications rejected. Out of 54,000, only 6,000 plus could get entry into Christ University in different campuses. Now some of them I met, and some of them very unhappy. Why? They didn't get the place of your choice. So first attempt will be, do what you love. Now, I said maybe a 2% people are lucky. How many of you are qualified during your internship? Or how many of you get placements? We don't know. Maybe a few, I'm sure. What about the others? So, please listen. If you cannot do what you love, what is the next option here? Learn to love what you do. Because we have another choice. Yeah, we can always go on complaining and murmuring. Does it help in any way? It doesn't. What we call job satisfaction never ever comes when there are a lot of complaints. I know I am talking ideals. In practical life, I find a lot of trouble. But whatever the job we do, until we get a better one, the question being asked is, are we trying to put our best? That's the meaning of learn to be happy with what you do. Otherwise, of course, the third option is there. You can leave what you do, but I don't recommend that. I don't want people to be an employee. You see, it is always better to light a candle than curse the darkness. In that way, whatever be the job, don't give up. But the second one, I would say that is the best. Learn to love what you do. Now, for your information, I don't teach English literature. Although that was my first love. Now I teach philosophy, management. So therefore, first policy we said, don't compare. Second tip, try to learn to love what you do. What will be our job? What will be our studies? See? Now, the third point. Don't give up. Don't give up when you have still something to offer. We become heartbroken very easily. You see, when my dream is not fulfilled, I heard the news in the past 2 in our junior college. One student expected very high mark, 19+, and he didn't get. And that evening, he committed suicide. I would say he's a very stupid. Why? I don't know. Have you heard this man, Robert the Bruce? He was a king in Scotland. The very famous story about the spider. Spider became a teacher for him. He lost 6 battles and he was running away and he was hiding in a cave. And while he was awake there and thinking about, he saw a spider making the web. The spider jumped once, twice, thrice, 4 times, 5 times, 6 times, no success. Then the 7th time the spider could reach the other side. So the first threat of the web was made, reached. And that was an inspiration for Robert the Bruce. He said, I lost 6 battles, the spider also lost 6 battles, but the 7th one, the spider won. And then he came out of the cave, assembled his men, went for a battle, and he won the battle. You see, our life is such. Sometimes we have difficulties. Sometimes we have problems. But just thinking over that, we are not happy. Rather, try our best. Give a second try. Give a third try. I know, for example, now, many young people will appear for a competitive test. I know there are people who talk about IELTS. People talk about NET. People talk about all exams these days now, medical exam, but they call it NEET. NEET. You see, now, one time you may not succeed. Especially very competitive test now. To be a NET, to pass a NET, it's not very easy. But to get an IELTS, for example, if you need 6 marks or 6 points, something, it's not very easy. What we have to do, keep trying. Keep trying. If not the first time, second time, third time, we can be sure. So that's what they're talking about. Now, one of the best examples we have in the history is Abraham Lincoln. I know it's a story known to everybody. Before he became the president of USA, the first citizen of the world, he lost 60 elections. When he was a young boy, he lost his mother. And since then, if you have picked up some of the, you see, 1832, he lost the first election. And when did he become the president? In 1860. So almost 28 plus years he lost elections. But he didn't give up. He had a dream. And that dream, he thought, if not today, tomorrow. And finally, remember that young boy of 1832 became the president in 1860. And that too, he made history, especially with the abolition of the slavery in the USA. How many of us would try, let's say, 5 times, 6 times? Because sometimes I listen to our brothers, problem is an exam, problem that are vocations, especially those who are studying Christ University, every day they have more and more problems because their friends speak about different things. And sometimes they say, oh, brother, you have no vocation. So they come back and ask, do I have vocation? Unfortunately, maybe you don't have such a problem. But about your studies, about your work, about your family, about your friends, don't give up. Try and try. One of the best examples I can present is, how many of you have read this one? The Old Man and Sea. Two, three, four. See, this is a novel which has won the Nobel Prize in Literature. This is Ernest Hemingway, The Old Man and Sea. Just only one character, an old fisherman. Every day he used to go for fishing, but he gets no catch. He returns home empty-handed. And meanwhile, a young boy saw this all melodramatic life. So he promised to help, but then a few days he was with the old man, the same result, no catch. So the old man persuaded the young boy to go away. Finally, this old man decided, let me go deep in the sea in his long boat. And that day he caught a huge fish. What? Now, that fish dragged him 3 days in the ocean because he was so huge he couldn't kill. And finally he came and he was drawing towards the beach. And what happened? When there was the smell of the blood, immediately life threatening sharks engulfed. And this man now has to keep your catch and also swayed or resist the attack of the shark. And he lost all his weapons, a harpoon, a knife, and a kind of small arrow. These were some of the weapons. He lost everything. Finally, he reached the seashore and pulled the catch out. And to his amazement and sorrow, he saw only a long skeleton, no flesh. Everything was eaten up by the shark. Now the other. Rights. A man can be destroyed, but not defeated. Take the history. Jesus was destroyed, but not defeated. Gandhi was destroyed, but not defeated. Abraham Lincoln was destroyed, but not defeated. Defeat comes only when we say, oh, I am defeated. I am lost. No external power can defeat us. They can destroy, yes. Remember the famous Julius Caesar. See, Julius Caesar was killed by Brutus. That can happen, but Julius Caesar lives. That's what he wrote. A person can be destroyed, but not defeated. Now, question to be asked, I will be happy to. Now, the next tip. I am sending two morals here. One is self-affirmation, the other is self-abnegation. What is the difference? Take the second one. Self-abnegation. The feeling that I can do nothing. I am nothing. Let me give a simple example from our brother's life. You see, we have two brothers. Some 10 years ago, at the time when Father Thotian was rector, you see, in the evening we have what they call Lilia and Chanson, you know that, night prayers. And one day in the night prayer, a brother was supposed to begin the psalm. And the psalm was not very good psalm. Can you imagine what could be that psalm? There is a psalm. And that brother who was supposed to begin, he didn't begin. Because he thought that is a fitting with the brother. So what happened? When he didn't begin, the rector started. He said, I'm not a man, but I will. And then the entire Tamaran community burst into laughter. Why? Because the poor man rector saying, you see, nobody today wants to say that I am a worm like, I am a slave. Everybody wants to be respected. That's what's the first point. You see, self-affirmation. Hear that man? Eric Erickson, the psychologist, who studied about the infancy up to the adolescence, spoke about three important things: self-respect, self-esteem, and self-confidence. Hope you understand, because these are common terms today, especially in the psychology class. Three words: respect, esteem, and confidence. Do you respect yourself? Yes? Do you have confidence in yourself? Do you esteem? Do you think you are valuable? You see, this is a question we should ask. But on the other hand, if you think I am nothing, I can do nothing, that doesn't give you a happy feeling. You see, did you listen to the Obama talk when he assumed office as the President of the United Kingdom, USA? Anybody? The talk of Obama? Nobody. That means you don't watch TV or what? Oh, you watch all Malayalam movies, man. You see, Obama concluded his inaugural address by this saying, yes, 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 we can. Yes, we can. Now, how many of us have that confidence to say, yes, I can? Or you begin to say, oh, I cannot. Then if you cannot, why you try? You see, we take it anticipatory way, oh, I cannot. Then we never try. On the other hand, what is self-confidence? The feeling, the happy feeling that I can. Then you can see your mindset will be quite different. Therefore, the first thing about ourselves is self-confidence. Now, tomorrow you will be mamas and daddies. One of the insights by Erickson is this: when children are young, at that time we should teach them to respect themselves, to esteem themselves, and to confide in themselves, so that when they grow, they will have self-respect, self-esteem, and self-confidence. If that is missing, they will miss respect, esteem, confidence in their lives. So this is another tip to be happy. Now, very practical question. This is from Venshaha, the man who taught him or teaching in Harvard. How do you spend your money? You see, this is scientific research. Those who spend their money for new experience like travel, sports, reading, classes, courses, creative work, they enjoy life more than those who spend money for food and drinks. Now, one thing Malayalam should be happy about, we are always number one in certain things. Now, today Onam and tomorrow Onam, now Kerala will be number one, especially near our place, Charikuri is number one northwest. I am from Angamali, very close. You see, why so? Because I studied in European countries, for example, in France, every time they take drink. But in my stay, I have been in Europe 91, since then every year. I have never seen except two cases in the hall, 91, 2001, 2011, you see, almost 30 plus years. I have seen only two cases of drunkards. In all Europe I am talking about, whether it be Germany, whether it be Belgium, whether it be Holland, whether it be France, whether it be Luxembourg, whether it be any other country, Italy or whatever. Although, you go to any family, every family has a personal bar. Even when I go to TJ University, in my room there is a bar. That does not mean I am always drunk, no. I am very careful when I am in a university outside India to behave properly, otherwise the second time you are not invited. Any bad reputation, that's enough. Any alleged bad reputation, that's enough. You never get a rejection. And you follow what I'm saying? But why we the Malus are so fond of, I don't say drinking is a bad habit, no. But why Onam, Christmas, Easter, I don't know what all the other occasions. You know better than what I do, because I left Kerala years and years and years ago. Now, the question is, scientific study says, now, how many of you have ready habits? You see, very few. For example, when you travel, especially by train, I'm not talking about flight and so on, we don't have much time in flight, except a couple of hours. But when you travel by train, you see, reading does not mean very costly book. You can get also paperback editions, magazines, journals. But Ben Shahab, the professor at the Harvard, this is a research, and he said 75% of the people are happy when they spend money on new experiences. Now, if you think drinking a good wine is a new experience, I would say go ahead. You see, one thing we should not forget, those who have studied economics should know, there is a law called law of diminishing marginal utility. Have you heard about that? Law of diminishing marginal utility. That means, for example, let me say ice cream. What could be the best ice cream in Bangalore? Yes. Have you heard about Madame Blanche, Madame Noir, Black Lady, White Lady? These are ice creams, number one ice creams in the world. You never heard. When you go to Italy, Italy is number one in the world for ice creams. You see? And you ask for a Black Lady will come. And White Lady. These are not ladies' place, these are name of the ice creams. Yeah, these are some of the best. Now, what will be the ice cream, how best it is, when you go on eating first time, second time, third time, fourth time, sixth time, then the taste comes down and down. That's what we call law of diminishing marginal utility. That's true about food, that is true about drinks, even they say, scientists say that is true about sex. Because such things in abundance, in plenty, the taste, the desire will be less. Remember Shakespeare's very famous, the 12th night's opening statement. If music is the food of love, play on, so that I may be satiated and long no more. If music is the food of love, you see the king was seen of fell in love with the lady, but the lady does not return the love. Therefore he is asking his court, people, to sing music, which is a substitute for love. So if the music is the food of love, play on and play on, so that I may be satiated, I may be content, I may be happy, so that I ask no more. Now therefore, you can think, how do you spend your money? I know in Christ University there are students who spend more than 1,000 rupees or more a day. I don't say all, but some rich guys. Now what for what? I don't know. So this is one point we have to think about. Now, when you take up certain task, try to do as early as you can. He'll say, face challenges, don't postpone. See, today I was reading a story from Vivekananda. Vivekananda, who for the first time spoke in United Nations. Then he gave an example. One day, a young boy Vivekananda was walking through a street near Varanasi. And then as he was walking down, he saw a group of monkeys in front of him and attacking. At that time, the young boy thought, what should I do? Should I run back? So he started running. You know what happened? All the monkeys got after him. So he was a bit afraid. But in his mind, there came an inspiring word, don't run. Don't run. So he stopped running and faced the monkeys. Monkeys stopped. And that example he gave in a journal. And he said, if you have a threat, confront. Don't run away. And that is the best medicine. That's the best way to be happy. For example, if you postpone, you know that word? Procrastination. What is procrastination? Putting things away. You see the famous saying in Macbeth, tomorrow and tomorrow and tomorrow. We can postpone and postpone, but that will never happen. Therefore, what he says is, if you can do it today, do it. Typically real to be happy. I'm sending you two words. One is typical Malu word, the other one is a Sanskrit word. What is the first word? Ta. What's the meaning of ta? In Malayalam, ta. Give to whom? Ta means to whom? Ta. Ta means give to me. And that is the famous word of Malus, including you and me. We all like to say ta, ta. When a baby is born, ta, ta. When a person is dead, finally ta. So from birth to death, womb to tomb, only one word, ta, ta, ta. And when we don't get ta, we are unhappy. So what is the simple tip to be happy? Change that ta into da. What is da? Da in Sanskrit means give, but not to me, give to them. You can experiment. The moment you are prepared to give your time, your talents, your ability, not only for you, I don't mean we not spend for ourselves, we need, but others as well. Then you can see the change in life. Because Jesus said, give so that you may receive more. Let me conclude with a simple experience I had. Last Good Friday, I was in a church in Belgium, in Brussels. You see, I was there. Remember, I was the only black man in the church. All others, Europeans, yes. Of course, they know me, I am a priest, because I have been there a few times. So I was in the third row, in the chapel, in the preview, okay? Now, there is a custom of distributing candles, and that candle should be lit in a particular time. Normally, the people bring the candle. If they don't bring, the church will provide that was sufficient. I could see a family of papa, mama, and two kids, a girl and a boy. They for God to bring four candles. They brought only two candles. And that one Papa took, one Mama took. I was just behind. I could see the two kids. They were struggling. They were pushing Papa and Mama, asking for a candle. I saw that. I had a candle, so I stepped out and gave that boy his candle. And he was very happy. You know what happened later? The mass continued. There was the sharing of the peace of Christ. You know, he said, what do we say? That's param samadhanam, yeah. The peace of Christ. Samadhanam ashes. Then at that time, this boy got out of his seat and ran to me and said, peace with you. You can imagine, I looked around, oh, I am now the big man. Are you following what I'm saying? I didn't do anything great. I had a candle which I picked up from the church. I gave to that boy. That's the only thing I did. I lost nothing. But what did I receive? A great appreciation. Everybody looked, why this boy is running to me? And then followed the boy, the papa, mama also came. So I became the hero in the church. Simply because I gave a candle which cost me nothing. That's what we are saying. Can we begin somewhere this mindset of giving da? Instead of saying da, da, da. You can see the change. Happiness, joy begins from there. It's the other thing I didn't say about God, because we all believers. Not only because I am a priest, in my life I had great escapes. One from the one from a train and one from the terrorist attack. Last time when there was a bombing in airport, Brussels, I was a witness. I escaped just a fraction of a second. You see, I was returning to Bangalore. I checked in. Then I moved toward the security zone. Just behind me, the first bomb exploded. Then there was an announcement, lie down, lie down. Four Korean cannot lie down because I play for football and basket. I have damaged both my knees. I don't have cartilage, so I can't. So instead of lying down, I just walked ahead. The second bomb exploded. All those are lying dead. Thank God the third bomb didn't explode because I was remote. The other one was suicide bombers. Only all debris, the dust fell on my body, that's all. I could see young children, women, all scattered bodies. I don't know why God spared me. I was the only person, that many people killed there, I was the only person rescued. Then I thought maybe God had something to serve for. That was my latest. That happened in April 22nd at Brussels. That's why I said you may have very good experience about God's blessing, God's health, God's help. Therefore, I didn't talk. I didn't talk much about that. But we as Christians, we are the more as believers to believe that God does exist. In the beginning, I spoke about Nietzsche. Nietzsche said God is dead. You know the history of Nietzsche? This man, once he said God is dead, he was under strain and lived 11 years as a madman. He lost his memory, he lost his sense, and his only sister, who refused to marry, to take care of him. And finally, he became normal, and then he wrote his last book, calling to his wife, God. He says, I'm not God, I'm not happiness, come back, come back. That was the last text written by the same Nietzsche who said, God is dead. So you see, unknown happiness, come back. So to be happy, two important things, faith in God and a new mindset where we can say, give so that we will receive more. Da instead of ta. Thank you. Thank you very much. Questions, but I don't promise I have answers, but you will try. Any questions? many languages, okay? You don't have much time. Maybe I need to go back.
Career.
No questions. Come on. Yes, please.
So, am I audible? Yeah.
Yeah.
So one of the things I want to compile with something that was a present among people, the corporate students everywhere. So what are your different things to do? So that, see, usually you might not compare ourselves, but if surrounding compares us with people, what do you suggest?
Yes. We are very prone to compare everybody. Now, one thing, whenever I give instruction to teachers, I tell the teachers in the classroom, especially in public, never make comparative statement. Don't say this boy is better than the other. No. Nobody would appreciate that. Also, I tell my papas and mamas, right? Don't make that comparison in front of us. When you are alone, if you say, no problem. But when there is a public, comparison is not the way. That will not help anybody. You will be happy when you say, oh, your brother is much better than you. No, we don't like. Even when they say, okay, you are much better than your brother, my brothers, you look at his face. Therefore, whether we teachers, even parish priests, sometimes our problem for this family is better than the other family. No, don't say it publicly. That can damage the relationship. Similarly, papas and mummies should be very careful. Don't make a comparative statement in the family when all are present. If you have this particular affection to somebody else, show it in private, not in public. That's it, my immediate answer. Otherwise, we are all very natural to compare. But unfortunately, that's not a good thing. Your studies will retire more in academics than in administration. I started teaching in June 1st, 1987, so you can imagine. Now, once again, thank you very much for your patience.
Thank you for coming. Hi all, good morning. Good morning. Yeah, like Father started off, please don't worry, be happy. Hakuna Matata. Okay, so I'm here to propose a vote of thanks today. I'm Alex from St. Thomas U. I would like to thank Father Dr. Kurian Kansakuri for his precious time here. We have some takeaways today, don't we? So what I was thinking is, when Father was explaining, I was looking into each and every one of you all. So what I felt was, you people were really concentrating too much on whatever Father was saying. So I felt that there is something that you all can answer whatever I asked. So Father was talking about five balls that, you know, the guy